The Apostle Paul writes, I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Good afternoon and welcome to St. Michael and All Angels Parish Church as we gather to give thanks for and celebrate the life of Caroline Margaret Bradshaw Berry, known to everyone, I think, as Margaret. Welcome to those of you here in the building. You are most welcome as we gather in person to celebrate Margaret's life. And welcome to those of you watching and listening online. Hopefully the technology is watching, and especially welcome to those of you watching in South Africa. Even though you're elsewhere, we gather together through all sorts of internet connections to be able to celebrate and remember together. Hopefully you've got sight of an order of service, those of you that are in the building. If you haven't, you either need to remember the words of the hymns off by heart and sing up as loud as possible so we can hear when you get a word wrong, or share with those around you. Hopefully you've got sight of the words. And so as we come together, we come to worship the Lord, but we come to celebrate Margaret and all that she meant to each of us. Let's take a moment to pause and to pray. We look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are seen are eternal. Today we come together to remember before God our sister Margaret, to give thanks for her life, and to comfort one another in our grief. Father in heaven, we thank you because you made us in your own image and gave us gifts in body, mind, and spirit. We thank you now for Margaret, for what she meant to each of us. As we honour her memory, make us more aware that you are the one from whom comes every perfect gift, including the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen. We sing together, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord.
Thank you.
Please be seated. We're now going to hear two tributes to Margaret from the family. And the first one is going to come on screen, hopefully. Unfortunately, Mike couldn't be here today as he's in South Africa, but he has recorded a message that he wanted to share, which hopefully is now going to appear.
Good day, everyone. Dear Mum, I am fit, I am well, and I am healthy. You passed away on Friday, 4 August at about 19:30, approximately 10 hours after we had last seen you. It was a relief and the end of a remarkable life on Earth. It is hard to understand what life was like when Mum was born in 1932, other than to know that she did survive the Second World War with a bomb exploding across the road from the room that she was sleeping in Garner's Lane. The next day, she told us how she and her mother crossed Manchester to find out how Nanny was in Bolton. And she often believed that she was one of the first people to cross Manchester after the bombings that became synonymous with Manchester's involvement in the war. So there was only courage in her makeup, a just can-do attitude. She was blessed to have a group of friends, Sylvia, Elsa, and Chris, that was established school and never left her. And there was not a day in my presence in recent years when she didn't mention the girls. These types of friendships are unique and only happen to special people, of which she is one. She also came from a time and generation when women's rights weren't equal. And I am sure that had she been living her life today, she would easily have been able to add to her own business career had she wanted to do so. She also wasn't scared of big decisions. For those that don't know, she sent Dad a Dear John letter on the day of his posting in the army. In terms of her life, when we became part of it and aware of it, there was never any doubt that Mum and Dad were a unit of one. And after his passing in 2015, there was a great cloud of loneliness that she carried with her, although not in a bitter way. As regards being a mother, she only ever wanted the best for us and would support us in anything we tried to do and to ensure that Andrew and I were both to be treated equally, which was also applied to her grandchildren. Of course, our task was not to make things easy for her. And I remember one specific evening when I had once again crashed one of Dad's cars. And when I got back, he was still playing golf, and Mum returned me off to college before he could return, which indicated her ability to take one for the team or for me, or she had the insight as to the consequences of what would happen if she allowed me to wait for his return. So, Mum, I have always known that you have had my back. For that, I thank you and apologize for any attempts to push you over the edge that may have crept in. When we were younger, we used to relish your visits to South Africa and your exploration of the rest of Africa on the many visits that you made. I was reminded of one of the overland trips you did through Northern Africa on a Bedford truck with much younger people. And the truck broke down, and although in age you were much more senior and potentially not as strong physically, your ability to produce a bottle of whiskey on the evening of such a calamity endeared you to the rest of the younger group, clearly displaying your ability to mix across all age groups. Although communication has been challenging over recent times, there is not a day that went past that I knew that you were not thinking of me and I of you. As I have become older, I've realized that it is not enough to go through life not telling people close to you that you love them, and this was never learnt or demonstrated by me until recently. And in recent visits, I have shared with you that I love you enormously and that no one could have had a better mother. and that the time is now right for you to join Dad and watch over us, knowing that the values and morals that you passed on to us, we in turn have tried to pass on to our children. Liz was always delighted with her relationship with you and said you were the best mother-in-law she could ever have had. Tom and Jack also enjoyed their relationship with their grandma. So now is the time for you to rest in peace as we continue to pray for you and remember you with love. Amen.
Thank you to Mike for recording that and sending that over. I'm now going to invite Andrew to come and say some words as well.
Hello, and it's lovely to see you all here today. Some faces I haven't seen for a while, but nonetheless very good to see you all. Margaret, daughter, wife, auntie, godmother, mother-in-law, granny, great-granny, teacher and friend to many, but most importantly to Mike and I, our mum. We received many cards and it's been heartwarming to read them, to hear what other people thought of mum. Astute, remarkable, a lovely neighbour, stoical, strong, a special friend who was forthright and firm in her beliefs. These are just a few of the tributes paid to mum. She was astute, very astute, using this skill to great effect when Mike and I were growing up. There wasn't much you could get past her, but we tried. She taught at Bramhall High School, my school, and indeed organised my first skiing trip to Aviemore, starting my lifetime's passion for skiing. She quickly sized up those children she would need to keep a closer eye on. And to her credit, the trip ran very smoothly, as indeed it did for many years following, although by this time, Mum had already handed the baton over to somebody else. As many of you may know, she also taught at Stile Prison and at Walthew House, teaching the blind for a number of years before retiring to spend more time on her hobbies. Playing golf at Hazelgrove and Bramhall Park golf clubs, where she won a number of competitions. Drive for show and putt for dough was a favourite saying of hers. She also played bridge for Bramhall Park with her partner Sue Aldroyd, and apparently they intimidated the opposition. Who would have thought that, hey? Although a plus score, I am told, of over 8,000 points one time is not to be scoffed at. Mum had two special groups of friends growing up. The girls, Auntie Sylvia, Auntie Chris, and Auntie Elsa, as Mike has already mentioned. Tuesday night was always the girls' night, and New Year's Eve was always spent in the company of the girls and their husbands, seeing out the end of one year and starting the next year. That's right, Sienna. Her other set of lifelong friends were the church girls, who she met at St. George's in Stockport all those years ago, where she first met Dad. I am delighted that Sylvia is here representing the girls, and Dorothy, the church girls. It's lovely to see you both again. Mum was determined, fearless and forthright, and firm in her beliefs. Someone you always wanted to have on your side. In her determination, however, she didn't suffer fools gladly, as a receptionist at Bramhall Health Centre found out to her cost. When during COVID, she was told there's no chance that she could be seen by a doctor today, she drove herself down to the surgery where she sat herself on the chair outside the surgery with her umbrella and waited. You guessed it, it wasn't long before she was seen. Mum was driving well into her late 80s. She had always taken Dad out on trips to his favourite places when she was ill. When he was ill. She was fearless in her driving from an early start. She took her test in the winter and narrowly avoided an accident, having to do an emergency stop to avoid another road user 15 minutes into the test. She told us the driving examiner was so impressed he passed her there and then following which they drove back to the test centre. Of course, you wouldn't be able to do that these days, would you? Apparently, she was told by a driving instructor to not be afraid of putting her foot down on the gas. Maybe this might be why Mum attended not one, but two speed awareness courses. I can't think of many 8-year-olds who have managed this. However, I think she was secretly pleased that she was the oldest in the room by at least 30 years. Mike and I, as responsible sons, however, did check her driving out after the pandemic. And safe to say that the earlier instructions of don't be afraid to put your foot down held true, as she was not daunted at all by the sight of a big truck coming up a hill on a narrow road. She and Dad travelled widely. New Zealand, Costa Rica, Nepal, the Far East, and Europe, undertaking many a walking trip with the Ramblers, where they made many other friends, and of course, those many trips to South Africa to see Mike, Liz, Tom, and Jack. When her first grandchild, Victoria, was born, she decided she wanted to be a part of her life. And although this would mean some sacrifices and curtailment of other activities, she told Dad of her plans and the changes they would be making to their lives. A routine was quickly established, which remained so when Josh arrived. They gave up their time to pick the children up from school, have them in the summer holidays, and were regular activities included ferrying them to Brookdale Youth Theatre, walks and picnics in the countryside, teaching them both how to bake. Ginger biscuits, fairy cakes, and lemon drizzle cakes being firm favourites. That 3-tier cake tin of hers was always full of something. And of course, jam making. Raspberry jam and bramble jelly were her favourites during many holidays to Morfa Nevin, when Victoria and Josh were little, we regularly emptied the hedgerows of blackberries to make bramble jelly. Although I've no doubt it was hard work looking after them both, she was very proud of her involvement in their upbringing. And we were very grateful to have her influence on their young lives. Her greatest compliment, she once said, was being called Mummy by her grandchildren. That's right. Although I'm not so sure Karen enjoyed being called Granny at that time. When considering what to say in this tribute to Mum, I asked Tors and Josh what their memories of their granny were. As mentioned above, cake baking and jam making were pretty high up there, closely followed by the story of the bomb, as Mike already mentioned. Another memory of their granny is the off cream. For someone who was adept at baking, cooking Sunday lunch for us all, and as she told Karen once, noticing on a gala dinner evening that the prawn starter was definitely off. Apparently theirs was the only table not to have food poisoning. But despite all this, Mum was somehow never good with double cream. Yes, for first of all for us, it was the sniff test. Oh, that's okay. Followed by a quick check on the sell-by date. Oh, it's only a week out. And yes, she'd glance around the table to see what everybody else thought as she did the final test. Finger in the cream pot. Yes, that's fine, she would say, and pour it out. Experience told us not to bother with the cream. Not everybody's perfect, hey? In the last few years, Mum had had to deal with a lot. A COVID pandemic robbed her of time with her family, both here and in South Africa. The pain in her foot that we could never quite resolve, despite numerous opinions and specialists and doctors. And of course, the time since Dad died had been long and hard for her. She missed him terribly every day, but I have no doubt that they are back together as one now, playing golf, arguing about bridge, and going on long walks. Mum, we shall forever remember and be grateful for your love, guidance, and patience. She taught me to read and write, which, believe me, was no easy task, requiring all of her patience, time, and hard work over many years. We count ourselves fortunate to have had you in our lives. Love always.
Thank you. I'm sure many of you will have memories that you can share with the family, and the family would love to share those memories with you. They invite you to join them in the parish centre in the hall after this service for refreshments. Please do join them and share your memories of Margaret with them. And if you wish to make a donation in memory of Margaret, there is a basket at the back, and those donations will be split between the Alzheimer's Society and WaterAid. We're now going to hear a poem, which I think Victoria is bringing us.
It's time for me to go now. I won't say goodbye. Look for me in rainbows, way up in the sky. In the morning sunrise, when all the world is new, just look for me and love me, as you know I loved you. Time for me to leave you, I won't say goodbye. Look for me in rainbows, high up in the sky. In the evening sunset, when all the world is through, just look for me and love me, and I'll be close to you. It won't be forever, the day will come and then, my loving arms will hold you when we meet again. Time for us to part now, we won't say goodbye. Look for me in rainbows, shining in the sky. Every waking moment, and all your whole life through, just look for me and love me, as you know I loved you. Just wish me to be near you, and I'll be there with you.
Our reading is taken from the first book of Corinthians, chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest of these is love. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We heard earlier of the things that Margaret liked doing and even the things that she was good at. She was good at travelling. She was good at getting her children out of trouble. She was good at baking, at playing golf, at bridge, just to name some of those that I can remember hearing only moments ago. And she did all those things, I hope, because she had a love of them. What are the things that you do because you love doing it? There will be the maintenance of the relationships. There'll be caring for people. There might be some sport in there. There might be, you might be one of those weird people that likes maths, and you do maths very often and regularly because you love playing with numbers. Our Bible reading today from 1 Corinthians 13 comes in a bit of an odd point in Paul's letter to the church in Corinth, because it comes in the middle of a whole section about people using those things they are good at for the betterment of the community. Paul is talking about spiritual gifts, and that all spiritual gifts, those things that God has given us to use to make the world a better place, they're all equal. They all have a place in the church, in society. He then goes on to talk about the unity of all people, and then before going on to talk about some more gifts, talks about love. We all experience love in different ways. There's the love of things we like to do. There's the love of places. There's the love of going from one place to another. And there's the love of family. We're gathered here today to mark an ending, to mark the ending of Margaret's earthly life. And so it would be easy for us to say that today we're marking the end of Margaret's love. But Paul says love never ends. Paul hints to us that love carries on even when life itself comes to a close. And he says that because of his understanding of where love comes from. As a child is born, almost instantly you have a love for that child. As you pick up a new hobby, somehow, somewhere, a love grows and develops, even when it's just the first time hitting a golf ball down a fairway. It may be that it goes straight down the middle and instantly a love is born. And if it hits a bunker, maybe that love takes a bit more cherishing. But love seems to grow, and you kind of think when it stops, that's the end. But Paul says no, love endures. Love continues. We're told elsewhere in the Bible that God is love, and those who live in love, God lives in them. And so what we begin to get is a picture that love isn't a human quality that humans have created in a scientific lab somewhere. But love comes from God. It is otherworldly. And so he says it continues beyond the grave. A lot of people, when they choose this reading, miss the end part of the reading out, which is quite frustrating, because actually I think the end bit, as we heard today, gives us an insight to those few words where we're told love never ends. The love each of you experienced with Margaret, whether as a son, a grandchild, as a family member, or the love that you experienced from Margaret having to play her at bridge or be a partner on the golf course or elsewhere, that love is merely a reflection of greater love. All of you will have looked in a mirror at some point today. You will have seen the reflection of yourself in that mirror. And as perfect as the mirror may have been, that image will still have been slightly distorted. Those of you watching on live stream have the displeasure of having to look at me right now. As ugly as I may look, it's because the camera is distorted. It's not a perfect image. You can get the most refined and perfect mirror in the world, and it will still not be a complete, accurate reflection of who you are. The love that you shared with Margaret, and the love that Margaret shared with you, is a close reflection of perfect love. But perfect love is God's. The love that Margaret knew through family, through relationships, through her activity in life, was a reflection of the love that God had for her. And that love did not stop on the day she died. That love that God had for Margaret welcomed her home into heaven, which is why we can gather today with certainty that her life continues. Just not here in heaven. Her love for all those who have gone before her continues as she is reunited with them around the banquet table of heaven. Her love for you continues because she looks down upon you this day from her place in heaven where she sits alongside her Saviour and friend. And so your love for her can continue. The shared interests, the shared values, the things she taught you to do can continue because we are told love never ends. Love never ends because love is the most powerful force in this world. Love is so powerful, it has defeated death, which is why we are able to gather here with hope and even with joy amidst grief, to celebrate Margaret's life, to give thanks for the love she shared for us, because that love came from God. And because love is so powerful, she has been welcomed home. The love Margaret experienced from God, you can know this day, not just as a reflection, but pure and true. Because in the work of the cross at Easter, God offers you his pure love. He chooses to walk alongside you and share each and every day of your life with you, giving you the strength on those harder days and giving you the joy in those moments of celebration. God is patient. God is kind. He is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. God does not insist on his own way. He is not irritable or resentful. He bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. God never ends. Within God's love, Margaret has been welcomed home into heaven. We can be confident of that. And in being confident in that, we can continue to share the love we had for Margaret and the love she had for us with one another. We can remember her in the way we continue to love one another and seek to change the world through that love. Amen. Mark's now going to lead us in a time of prayer.
Let us pray. God of mercy, Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks for Margaret, for the grace and mercy she received from you, for all that was good in her life, but especially for the memories we treasure today. We thank you for the strength of Margaret's faith, for the constancy of her compassion and friendliness, the love she showed to family, friend, and church. Margaret's good works undertaken in your name, Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You promised eternal life to those who believe. Remember for good your servant Margaret, as we also remember her. Bring all who rest in Christ into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. And Lord, speak to any here now who do not yet know you. Let them feel your saving grace and fill them with a desire to embrace your love and grow in faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Look in mercy on all who mourn, but we pray especially today for Andrew and Karen, Mike and Liz, Victoria, Josh, Tom, Jack, and all the wider family. Give them patient faith in times of darkness. Strengthen them with the knowledge of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You are tender towards your children, and your mercy is over all your works. Heal memories of hurt and failure. Give us wisdom and grace to use the time left to us here on earth to turn to Christ and follow in his steps in the way that leads to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We now bring all our prayers together using the words that Jesus taught us to pray in the words of the Lord's Prayer. So we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We stand to sing, Great is thy faithfulness. So let us commend Margaret to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power, Christ has conquered death and entered into glory. Confident of his victory and claiming his promises, we entrust Caroline Margaret Bradshaw into your mercy, in the name of Jesus our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you, now and forever. Amen. Reminder, you are invited to join us for refreshments in the parish centre as our service concludes. And as we go, may God give you his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and all those you love, this day and always. Amen.